Well, good day, my friends. It's your old pal, Jordan the Lion. How are you all doing today? I hope you said great. We have a windy day here in Plainfield, New Jersey, but I wanted to come and visit and explore the life of a great comedian, musician, the great Dudley Moore. If you were a fan of his in the 80s, you might know him better as Mr. Arthur Bach, Daze of Jordan the Lion, and you all. It begins right now.
It's terribly small. Tiny little country. Rhode Island could beat the crap out of it in a war. That's how small it is.
It's small.
85 cents in a cab from one end of the country to the other. I'm talking small here.
We understand it's small.
I believe this is our place. We are at Hillside Cemetery in Scotch Plains. I think he is right over here. I think I looked over and saw a headstone over here. And I'm like, is that deer part of the headstone? And then it immediately turned around and started walking away. That's crazy. I felt like I was being watched. I can't blame him back here for wanting to visit Dudley Moore also. Here he is tucked in between and under these trees right here. Of course, he was from England. So I was kind of surprised that he would be buried in New Jersey, but he had a kind of a weird upbringing, so I can understand that he wouldn't be there, but oh, this is great! I have not seen this before. I'm a huge, I mean huge, Dudley fan, especially from the Arthur movies, but I loved him in everything. I think his personality was very, very likable. I mean, you felt like you knew him. He was self-effacing, he was funny, he was witty. There he is playing his piano, his beloved piano. I think that was the true love of his life. Sadly, at the end of his life, he would end up with a disease that would basically give him the symptoms of Parkinson's without the shakes, where he would lose his ability to control his muscles. He wouldn't even be able to play the piano at the end of his life. Dudley Moore, famous for Arthur. I think that's where that's what he went down as probably his most successful film. Even got an Oscar nomination for it. I saw him interviewed it several times. Every time he was interviewed, people would always ask him about his height. If he was, if he was self-conscious about his height, and he always said no. It was always the people asking him that were, I think, hoping for that answer, but he never did. That was something he just accepted and lived with. And he was asked, did you worry that when you made Arthur that people wouldn't accept it, they wouldn't like that you were making a lovable drunk when that's such an epidemic in the world of people having drinking problems? He said, I didn't, because first off, the script was the funniest script I'd ever read in my life. And he said, and I felt that Arthur had a big heart, and that really Arthur was, he was this rich guy who had $750 million, but he didn't really have anybody that loved him. And so that's why he drank. And I felt like Arthur was the kind of guy, if he got that love, that he could quit drinking. And so that is what we put in the movie. And so I never thought of it that way. He said, I always thought of it as, I thought it was a real art that people that could be and could play a convincing drunk. So I kind of had always wanted to do it. And I think they gave the movie such a great life. I mean, it was, like he said, it wasn't about the drinking, it was about Arthur's story. And he found so many funny ways in those movies that were just so Dudley. Like, I mean, if you watch the scene where he's meeting with Bert and he keeps commenting on the the moose on the wall. And he goes, what happened to the rest of this moose?
Drinking affects your decision making.
You may be right. I can't decide. It's just a little humor. Where's the rest of this moose?
Either.
Or when he ends up in the Arthur 2 on the rocks, they made a sequel. He ends up having to get a job and he's working at the hardware store and he can't even figure out how to make a key copy. Just so lovable.
Look, Penny, you could win $1 million with this.
Well, $1 million?
$1 million.
That means if I won 750 of those, I'll be back where I started. Right?
Let's just take them one at a time, all right?
The guy's story was really interesting. You know, he had a set of parents who really kind of kept their household like a fortress. They didn't let him really make that many friends. Occasionally they would, but they had to like the friends. And his mom could be very loving, but would just blow up out of nowhere. So she also treated him kind of like a freak. He was short for his age. He had a clubbed foot, and she kind of, instead of being one of those parents who taught him to accept and deal with his shortcomings or his challenges in life, she would make a big deal about it. So he would use his humor to deflect anything at school. And when his sister started learning piano, Dudley, it turns out, was actually a natural. He blew his sister out of the water. And in a very short time, he was not only playing classical, but he was actually better than his teacher. His teacher said, I would put stuff down in front of him that I couldn't even play, and he could play it. So Dudley was so good that he got a scholarship to Oxford as an organ player. And he played in the glee clubs and all that kind of stuff, and learned classical in his free time. He would learn jazz because he loved jazz. And when he was all finished there, they actually offered him the job of choral director and full-time organist. But he said he never saw himself as a teacher. And so when the opportunity came for him, while he was in Oxford, by day he would be going to school, but by night he was in a band. So he got an opportunity to go play in a show and ask the school, hey, can you give me permission to leave for a couple of weeks to do this show and then I'll come back? And they said, Dudley, you're never coming back. You're too good. Be on your way. And he took off and his career just soared from there. He found that when he would join different groups or any kind of performing act, he had a natural cabaret ability about him. He was not only a good piano player, but he could do funny things while he played. And it would turn out that the people would all start watching him, and he would just bring the house down with his behavior. And so various people saw this. He ended up on TV. He was on a show with Peter Cook, and that was actually international. So he ended up coming over and doing this show in New York on Broadway. And then he and Peter Cook actually went off and were going to start to do like a duo. But Dudley just felt like he wasn't a duo guy. And in the mid 70s, even though he had made some movies in Britain and everything, he was dating Tuesday Weld. And she wanted to go back to America and live. And so he said, okay. She wanted to live in Los Angeles. So he went, and wasn't very long by the time he got there, even though he was much shorter than your normal leading man, his charisma just soared through. And one day his agent gets a call and they say, you have somebody on your roster who is about to become a sex symbol. And his agent said, wait, what? They said, George Segal just dropped out. We're 2 weeks into making the movie 10. We want Dudley. And they cast Dudley in the movie, and his career just absolutely took off from there. He was lovable. In the movie, they made him, you know, very attractive. He was in there with Bo Derek, so absolutely a hit. But then he made a movie after that called 6 Weeks. That was a heartbreaking movie. It was a movie about parents losing their child. And the writer and director said, you know, when we were doing this, we knew it was a really heavy movie. So we wanted somebody that could bring some lightness to it. And so they cast Dudley to be the father. And when he was on set, they said very early in the production, there was a set that they were at that had a piano. And Dudley, every time there was a piano around, he would always start playing it. And so the director said it just put everything and everyone in a good mood. So I just made it mandatory. There had to be a piano on set. And Dudley would just play all the time. And one day he said, I walked by and I heard him playing this amazing thing. And I said, what is that? And he said, I don't know. I'm just messing around. And he said, can we use that as the theme for the movie? Would you compose the theme for 6 weeks? And he did. And it was actually his favorite thing to work on. But when it came out, it was basically a flop because the subject matter was just so heavy for so many people. But one of the women that was on the movie, Brogan, years later he would reconnect with and end up dating and marrying. And she would track down his very first piano through his sister. They found out who bought it and were able to get the piano back, put it in Dudley's house, and then blindfolded him, walked him in. And he was showing, I saw an interview where he's actually with Oprah, and he's showing Oprah this piano. He said, this was my first piano, and it'll be my last piano. I think he was amazing in everything he did. Even if the movie wasn't a real commercial success, he was always great in it. I mean, he was in Mickey and Maude, and you had 10, and you had like Father Like Son, and of course the two Arthur movies. But he loved the music. So intermittently, he was out actually doing shows all over the place with a trio, sometimes a symphony. And this would happen all through the 80s and into the 90s. Dudley would continue acting, but then people started to notice some change had taken place in him. And he was making a movie with Barbara Streisand and got fired because they thought he was drunk all the time. He was slurring his speech and he was kind of stumbling around. And so he started performing more out in doing his shows on the piano. And then all of a sudden, those performances started to suffer because he said he could feel his pinky when he would try to hit a note. It would either not move or it would double move. And so it turned out that he had a 4-year process of going to doctors trying to figure out what was wrong with him. Talk about that over at the home where he passed away, because I really want to talk about what he suffered through the end of his life, because it was so bad that he actually had 2 children, and one towards the end of his life was in his early 20s and the other was only 4 years old. Dudley would say, I don't let my children see me anymore because I don't want them to see me deteriorate. That's got to be a very sad position to be in, to where you see that you are dying and that you don't want your kids to see that. Dudley S.J. Moore. See, he was not very old. Born in 1935, passed away 2002, in his 60s. Cherished friend, celebrated musician, actor, and comedian. So now I want to go over to his last home where he passed away. And I think part of the reason why he was living out here and why he would be buried here is because it wasn't until he had a friend named Raina who originally had interviewed him years before and they had become friends.
And she started helping him try and figure out what this illness was that he was dealing with, because she was actually a really great pianist herself, and they used to collaborate and everything together. And so she saw how upset it was making him that he was losing his ability to perform the way he liked to. And so it was finally a doctor in New Jersey that was able to figure out what was wrong with him, and he used to be treated, Dudley would be treated here.
Hey, did you see that deer out there? That was pretty crazy, wasn't it? His last home is actually just like 2 minutes away from here.
So I found online that Dudley was living in this house at one point. He had several houses, various places. He had a place in Marina Del Rey at one point, and Nova Scotia in the summers, but he would live here for a while, right around when he was finding out that he was ill. And so I was kind of shocked that he passed away next door, but then what I read was that he had gotten this house for his friend Raina. He was living here, and in 1998, I guess, is when they had found, or they moved here after he found out that he had something called progressive supranuclear palsy, and that basically caused him to lose his ability to control his muscles or anything. And finally, he would eventually end up not being able to play the piano, which he loved. And his health just declined from there. And Raina, actually, from what I read, was that he got her this house so she could help take care of him, and then moved him in. And actually, she had a family, a husband, kids, grandkids, everything, and she set her life aside to help take care of him here. So he ended up passing away here, sadly. That's sad, because he did an interview with Barbara Walters, and she said, "What's the worst part of this?" And he said that, "I can never play piano again." I'm just gonna only get worse and die eventually, and I fear that it's going to be painful. Now apparently, even though what he had was really bad and it made everything basically slow down and stop working, there was nothing about it that seemed like it would kill him. They just said unless he choked, like where he had problems swallowing, or got pneumonia. And then sadly, that's what ended up killing him, was that he did end up contracting pneumonia, and he passed away in this house. What a great lady to take care of him. He was married several times, but none of them lasted, so it was this great friend that really got him through his last days. Rest in peace, Dudley Moore. Thank you all for watching. See you next time. Goodbye.